retirement, semi-retirement, something, but he's headed down to Arizona. So if you think 100 degrees is bad, just think again. Exactly. That's exactly. He taught anthropology and related courses in environmental studies and Latin American studies at Linfield from 1983 to 2019.
I belong in a museum, I think.
That's a long haul. Right. Good for you. His topic today was published in the Oregon, come on in, have a seat. Today was published in the Oregon Historical Society's Quarterly Journal, really great article. Of course, after today, you won't necessarily need to read it, but it is good reading. I wanted to also thank, of course, TVCTV for covering this for us. And I'm just going to hand it over to you to give you as much of that hour as you can possibly use, okay?
Terrific.
Thank
Terrific.
You.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, thank you for your presence and for your attentive engagement with what turns out to be a convoluted story. And the origin of the name Oregon being the most disputed of American place names is a 250-year-old mystery that I was privileged to dive into, and I think we've got a pretty good argument for its origin in New England Indian languages, and I'll trace this convoluted story. But a few caveats. First is, being a college professor, I'm paid by the word, and so I'll try not to run long, but let me get through this the nuts and bolts of this argument or this story before we get into questions, because there are about 500 rabbit holes we could go down, which is why it took a long time to figure this out, and then have some Q&A at the end, and then you've got some refreshments after the recording's done. And then secondly, the image I want to have you keep in mind is the old vaudeville act, you know, of the bamboo, you know, with the plates, spinning plates, right? And so, because there's this is not a linear argument by any means, right? And a linear story, right? So it's going to be moving. Oh, well, we got to go back here and move this, right? So we're kind of bouncing around. So if there's some point that is short or some question that, you know, wait, what's that, right? But longer questions, let's try and reserve toward the end if we could. Okay. Thank you. So thank you for this opportunity. And I'm glad to have this recorded as well, because I've given the talk a couple of times, but it's convoluted, so it's good to get it down, is the idea. Okay, so Oregon the Beautiful, and it's wonderful that it means that. Okay, so generally, why does language matter? Well, these place names, like Oregon, carry stories. It's an inventory of past and present worldviews. Speech, certainly important, shaping our interaction, how we talk about things. We were ruminating on the origin of the name Tualatin, which had to do with a saloon across the corner there, right, as we learned. If we want to, we can get into more general issues about language and speech, which are very much part of anthropology, my field. And of course, we're talking about etymology, not entomology, insects, right? But etymology, the origin, study of word origins, and place names, again, carry these meanings, like the early Willamette Valley. You know, what does Willamette mean? Or these early place names, you know, which point to the excitement, you know, what was in the minds of the first white folks out here who came across the Oregon Trail. New era. Wow, new era, Oregon. Oh, that's a name. Wow, Amity. And then my own work in Latin America and southern Peru, Arequipa, has turns out finding out the meaning of that word, which was much disputed, was important because it refers, then it goes back into the history, and you start to, okay, that's how people thought about it, and that's where that name comes from, and it carries meaning. Ingatambo, another one in northern Peru. Anyway, the word Oregon came up in an intro cultural anthropology class, gosh, 25 years ago now. We had a new edition of our text, and so we were going through, had a little section on language, because language and culture are very, of course, closely tied. And they were talking about words borrowed into English, you know, Native American Indian words, right? And things like raccoon, chipmunk, toboggan, squash, these are all Indian words that came into English, right? And it goes on, talks about, and of course, many geographic features, the names of mountains and names of rivers, even the names of some states, Minnesota, Iowa, Oregon. I go, Oregon? That's funny. I thought in the back of my mind, I thought there was some question about the origin of the name Oregon. So after class, I'd go back and pull down my handy-dandy Oregon Geographic Names, 5th edition. Be sure not get caught without your copy. Pull it down, and I'm going, my gosh, there's 4 pages not known. And I go, what? How could this possibly not be known? Surely somebody's looked at this, right? Oregon Trail, Oregon Territory, this is important not only for us, but in this part of the world, but for, the history of the country. So so just a big story. So Oregon is our topic here. What is this name and where did it come from? And it's a 250-year-old mystery, and it's not like people didn't try. Lots of many guesses from similar sounding words. Of course, the Spanish, we know, generally from our 6th grade history or whenever we study history, early Spanish explorers. So maybe it had to do with Aragon, which is a, province in medieval Spain in the north near the Pyrenees. Kind of sounds, maybe, it reminded them of Aragon or something, right? Huracan, possibly, which is related to French Uragan. Well, now that's interesting. That kind of sounds right. The French were early explorers out here, as we're going to see. One of the spinning wheels here now, spinning plates. Means windstorm or hurricane in French. Oregano, the early explorers found plants that reminded them of oregano, maybe. Orejones refers to long-eared natives, and that was a bodily modification that some of the Northwest Coast tribes did. Or orejones, right? So it reminded, maybe orejones, maybe, right? Searching for words that sounded similar, right? Two Shoshone words an author proposed some years ago. I don't even know how to pronounce it. Ogwa Pion, and that got picked up by the French, he argued. But again, little or scant, if no evidence. It just kind of sounded right, okay? The most recent of these is Uligan. Uligan was a paper that came out while we were in the midst of our own research, and I thought, oh my gosh, we've gotten the scoop, right? Came out in the OHQ, the Historical Quarterly, that argued, nice paper, that argued David Lewis and Scott Byram, that Uligan, which is a Nootka name for smelt, the anadromous fish that comes up, is very oily, and that Nootka passed into Chinook jargon, which was widely spoken here in the latter part of the 18th and into the 19th centuries. Many Chinook jargon words, of course, around in place names. And there was the grease trade across the coastal mountains in British Columbia into the interior was, they described very well. And so they argue, well, the word associated with rivers got out to the east where this guy, Robert Rogers, another spinning plate, we're going to get to this in a second, maybe picked it up, no evidence, right? So I want to make the point that all of these are, there's some plausibility. I mean, maybe, right? But what constitutes evidence and what kinds of evidence do you need turns out to be, of course, a key problem. And our effort, as I'll describe here at length, utilizes two independent lines of evidence, which is why we think we're on pretty firm ground, both historical evidence as well as linguistic evidence, right, as you'll see. So Oregon, us natives say it that way, versus Oregon, Easterners, and we bristle at that, right? I was actually going to laugh in the middle of, as we were finding all this out, right, if it turned out the original pronunciation was Oregon, that would have been nice. But okay, so from the 1780s, to 1920, so for about 150, not quite, years of this 250-year mystery, it was thought that Jonathan Carver, who we're going to meet here in a little bit, was the originator of the name Oregon, because he wrote a book that circulated widely in England about his travels in interior North America, Minnesota and that area, and he talked about the Oregon River. Say where he got the name, didn't say what it meant, he just talked about it, right? So it passed into his journals then, which were widely read. Lewis and Clark carried a copy of Jonathan Carver's Travels in Interior North America with them. And that he was so honored, if you will, for being the originator of the name, that his name is carved in the west side of the Multnomah County Library. If you look at great historians, great explorers, right, next time you're down there, and there's Carver, because it was built in 1914. Why do I say that? Because in 1920, it was demonstrated that the word was not Carver's at all. It was belonged to Robert Rogers. We're going to get to that in just a second. Okay, so I'm looking in the Oregon Geographic Names, and the fifth edition shows that the trail seems to peter out in Wisconsin. And there's a 1715 French map where this guy, the author, argues that there was a slip of the pen, and a river named there was Hurricane Sink. And that somebody Robert picked that up or something, and it became ally, you know, to the name. Now, Wisconsin turns out to be crucial, but not for the reasons Stuart thought. So I thought, oh, that's interesting, and I'm an avid birder, and I remembered that there's a famous wildlife refuge in Wisconsin, southern Wisconsin, called Horicon. Some of you may know it, Horicon Refuge. I thought, Horicon? Well, now that's wild. Maybe there's some connection here, right? So I called up the city manager in Horicon, right? Anyway, found out that Horicon was, talk about rabbit holes, Horicon was named Beaver Marsh, and nobody liked it back in the 19th century. So they took a vote, and the name Horicon prevailed. Why? Because Horicon was the name of a lake, Lake George, in the kind of the southeast Adirondacks, okay, over in that area. And I thought, oh, this is real interesting. We were on the trail here, right? And the guy was, the resident who proposed that was from that area, and he thought it sounded good, better than Beaver Marsh, right? So let's call it Horicon. Turns out that has nothing to do with it, but that was it. That led me in the right direction. So I thought, I bet that it has something to do, because we all know that our history here. Oop, let's see. This is now not advancing. Here we go. So okay, so here's Rogers. There are actually no known portraits of him in life, but he's an imposing guy, and. He was the sort of the great hero of the French and Indian Wars in New England. Rogers Rangers, you may know about this. There's a movie, Spencer Tracy, back in the 40s that played on this, right? It's a terribly interesting story. And Rogers was a New Englander, and now this is British North America, pre-revolutionary America, right? United States. And he was very much working with Indians who were allied to the British, because the French and Indian War, you know, was between the British and the French, with Indian allies. Some went with the French, some tried to stay neutral, some allied with the British. So really, that was the right. And so Rogers winds up being the very much part of the campaign against the French in New England. That culminates finally in the French ceding a big territory. We'll get to that in another second, another spinning plate here now, to the English in 1760. So this is about 1758, okay? Now, fast forward, I'm jumping over the crucial period here, but we need to move around, okay? So this is his petition, and this was discovered by the historian T.C. Eliot over in Walla Walla. Banker over there, and published widely. And in 1920, there's a couple of articles, he's the one that found this, okay? And so here's he's proposing in 1765 to the King of England, the King's Privy Council, for funding to go explore and find the great river of the West. So Rogers thinks, right, and of course, Rogers is the hero. This guy knows the back country. He's like this with allied Indians, right? This is the guy. The route Major Rogers proposes to take is from the Great Lakes toward the head Mississippi, this old time writing, right? And from thence to the river called by the Indians Oregon, which flows into a bay that projects northeastwardly into the country from the Pacific Ocean, and there to explore the said bay and its outlets, and also the western margin of the continent, to such a northern latitude as shall be thought necessary. This is the first time, then, Eliot showed in 1920 that the word Oregon appears in print. Okay, so the problem with all those previous guesses that we went through, or attempts to find a word that sounded right, is that none of them, nobody, particularly since 1920, has put Rogers in the middle of it, which you have to, before 1765 when he wrote his petition. We were surprised. Nobody's done that. Whatever argument there seems plausible has to have Rogers at the center and has to be before 1765. Okay, so let's, a lot of context here to get in the air, a lot of place to be spinning to understand this. So one of the big ones, of course, is the search for the Northwest Passage. Why? Well, the Europeans were all trying to get to the riches of China and East Asia, dimly aware of the geography, right? And of course, the Spanish and the Portuguese went around through the Indian Ocean, Spanish, right? They're all trying to find a water, and specifically the French and the British are trying to find a water route across North America. They're trying to find the great fabled River of the West that they could sail down and get to the Pacific. Of course, the British and French are the main European powers duking it out here, exploiting Indian divisions and allies in this lucrative westward expanding trade, fur trade. Now, why? So we need to talk about boreal forest and Indian languages. Rabbit holes. Okay, so why? Well, because the fur trade, of course, why do the fur-bearing animals have fur? Because they're in cold climates, right? And so the fur-bearing animals are largely in the north here. And so here's the current beaver range, primary historical beaver range. And so the secondary, tertiary, right? So you can see that the main fur trade then was proceeding westward using Indian intermediaries all the way along, westward up toward the Rockies across the Canadian, of course, there's no Canada at this point, across the what's now the Canadian prairies, through the boreal forest, right? Here's the boreal forest of northern Canada and then the similar forest here in the Great Lakes region in New England. Well, and of course, the geography, really Ice Age geography, right, that left a whole series of lakes and rivers that all facilitate canoe-based travel, right, through this region, all was facilitating the westward push of the fur trade. We know this, right, because they finally got out here. Now, this is a map that shows all of the major Indian groups that Lewis and Clark encountered. And so people have, in their journey up the Missouri and then across the Rockies and out to the mouth of the Columbia. And it turns out that there's nothing like the word Oregon in any of these languages. People have searched all this. None. Nothing, right? Of course, the Ooligan and Chinook jargon, maybe, but okay. So we have to look a little farther afield. Okay, well, it turns out, and I remember this from my graduate classes, that the sort of linguistic geography of Native North America, right, that the main languages of that, you know, here's the push of the fur traders, right, northwestward, were Algonquian languages. Okay, Western and Eastern Algonquian languages. And of course, these were the languages that the British first encountered, raccoon, chipmunk, those are all Algonquin words, okay? So I thought, quick, I need an Algonquin linguist. So wonders of the internet, right? I go to the Society for Linguistic Anthropology. Help, I need an Algonquin linguist. I bet it's something like, Oregon's something like land of many beavers or something like that, right? That seemed like a good hunch, okay? So within, you know, it's hardly any time, right? Three hits. Talk to Ives Goddard at the Smithsonian. Okay, so I call up Ives. I said, "You don't know me. I'm parachuting out of nowhere, right? And right, but I've got, a real interesting project here." And so we talked, and right, it turned out ironically that his niece worked at Linfield, right? Anyway, small world. But so we got to talking, and he goes, "Oh my gosh, this, you know, the wheels are turning," and he's, you know, the guy for languages that are hardly spoken, if not extinct now. These Eastern Algonquin languages. He's the guy that figured out, I think this is right, what Manhattan means, for example. Land of canes for making arrows. That's an Algonquin word. Okay, these sorts of things. Okay, now by the way, the Shoshone, so Chinook jargon was out here. That's not shown on here because that's a trade jargon, not native language. But here's Shoshone, right? So the idea that Shoshone could have, you remember the, that, you know, could it have drifted across over to here? But Rogers is clear out here. Okay. And Rogers in his journal, so part of this was reading through Rogers, he had two books, although his main journals were lost in a canoe accident, but reading through his journals, and it's very clear that he's making distinctions. He doesn't confuse Indian groups or languages. He's very clear, and he's clear he's paying close attention to their geographic knowledge, particularly because the British are relying on them to, you know, where are the rivers and all this, right? So here's, zooming in on that language map, here's the Eastern Algonquin languages, Delaware, right, Mahican, which James Fenimore Cooper corrupted into Mohican. But here's Mohegan, not the same as Mahican. Rogers is crystal clear. These are separate people. And the Mohegans, oh, and then these are the Iroquoian languages, different language family, okay? Seneca is going to be important. We'll come back to that. Oneida, League of the Iroquois, all this, right? Okay. Remember Mohegan, because it was Mohegan Indians who were the British, the closest Indian allies of the British, fought with them closely in the movement, as long as I'm on this map, northward toward the French territories up toward Montreal, fighting through the Lake Champlain and all this area in a sequence. Oh, it's gripping history. Side by side, fighting all the way to Montreal, to where the French then, main capital there was, that finally fell in the fall of 1760. Now, let's pause for a minute. The French, of course, were about a century ahead of the British in exploring interior North America. And so the French were crucial for the transmission of Indian geographic knowledge, culture, language, to the English. I mean, the English used the French, right, to get to Indian knowledge, right? And so here's, for example, Champlain's map of New France in 1612. You know, they're clear, look at this. I mean, they're clear into, here's starting into the Great Lakes. They already knew about this in 1612, right? The English settlements were barely off the ground in hugging the coast, the Atlantic coast. So the French were way ahead, and so here's British, French, and Spanish spheres of influence about 1750. Okay. And so, the British colonies on the seaboard. And here were these these key battles, right, that finally led to the fall of Montreal, you know, key entrepot and fort, in 1760. Okay, so the French... Oh, let me skip ahead. This is just showing trade routes with the fur trade actively in the, you know, Hudson Bay and finally out to the west. Okay, so finally, then in the fall of 1760, now are we bogged down here? Oh my gosh! Right, a million things going on here. But hang on. Okay, so the fall of 1760, Montreal falls. All of this area then is ceded to the British. Falls into British hands. So the British now are flush with victory. They're moving up the St. Lawrence River through the Great Lakes, right? And to take possession of these forts. Okay, now they pause here in western Pennsylvania, what's now Presque Isle, and Rogers goes down with some Indians, maybe Mohegans, we don't know, to Fort Pitt, now Pittsburgh, which was up until then the westmost British fort, okay? And to get instructions on what they're supposed to do. Okay, so it turns out that they crossed over to the what's now the Allegheny River, which joins the Ohio at Pittsburgh, right, at Fort Pitt. They sailed down, they floated down it, got the instructions, and then went back and joined the main party up on the shores of Lake Erie. So why is that important? Because it turns out, okay, we've got to get to some place names. Again, we'll come back to this here. And we'll come back to this. Let's go to here, okay? So they cross over to get to Fort Duquesne or Fort Pitt, because in Rogers' day, the Ohio River. This was all the Ohio River. And it turns out Ohio is the Seneca word for that river, and it means beautiful river. That's what Ohio means. I mean, I don't speak Seneca, right? But, okay. And so we need then to go, forgive me, to this map now, which is a map of Franklin's map from the La Salle expedition in 1682, which is the first main French foray deep into the Mississippi. They discover the Mississippi River, okay? And they come up the Great Lakes, right? To Chicago, they cross over, portage over, and they come down. La Salle died in Texas. And then Franklin produced this map, and it turns out this map, of course, Goddard's the guy that knows all this, right? Right? And it turns out on this map, here is the Ohio River. Well, it turns out they never were on the Ohio River. This expedition themselves. But let's blow it up here. I don't know if you can see this. There are three names for the Ohio River. Ohio or Sippy. Sippy means river. It's hard, not knowing what that is. Or Olegin. So it turns, now why would there be three names for the same river on this map? Because La Salle had picked up allies, Algonquin-speaking allies, up in Montreal or Quebec for the journey. And so clearly some of the Algonquin speakers, Abenakis, had told them that our name for the river is Olegin, not Ohio. Now, the Seneca name is what stuck, for reasons I don't know, but Olegin didn't, right? Well, it turns out that Olegin, and this is detailed, this is the linguistic line of evidence, is detailed in our paper, is the same word, because words change over time, pronunciations change over time, we know that, right? Change to, in L, in the 17th century, was rare in Algonquin languages. It was more R, L and R close, right? But by the 18th century, it had shifted, and R was rare. L was more common, okay? And so Olegin in Algonquin means beautiful river. It's the same meaning, okay? But by the 18th century, Rogers's time now, in the French and Indian Wars, the R was very restricted. And so what is the Mohegan's name for the Ohio, that they applied to the Ohio River? Oregon. I'm garbling that a bit, but Oregon, okay? Which means beautiful river. Now, by the way, that doesn't mean beautiful like pretty. It means good for navigation. That's a beautiful river. It's got that sense more, okay? So the R in Oregon to name a river that 100 years earlier was with an L is a telltale piece of evidence that links it to the Mohegan. And the Mohegans, remember, were like that, fighting with alongside Rogers in the campaign, okay? And they were with Rogers and the British detachment moving up to take possession of these French forts. And Rogers had to go. He was on orders to go to the Ohio River. So he had every reason to learn the name of the Ohio River and that his Algonquin Abenaki-speaking colleagues, Mohican-speaking colleagues, called it Oregon. Now, there's no document that says I, Robert Rogers, learned that this meant. It's not like that, right? But it's hardly an inference to say that he learned that Oregon means beautiful river, the same as Ohio, the name for this river, and that was the Algonquin name for it. Okay, so when we got to that point, that was like, oh wow. Okay, now we're on the trail here, but then things went kind of quiet. So, well, why would he use that to name the River of the West? We're still way out in east of the Mississippi. What's going on here, right? And we sort of ground to a halt, and then that's when the Ugin paper came out with, oh my gosh, we're And so, and this is the, for the, you, young guy, the sheer thrill of figuring this out. It's a hot summer day, kind of like we've had, right? I'm out in my office in McMinnville, right? And working on stuff, right? And the, the phone rings and it's Ives. And he goes, he's like shaking. Tom, you won't believe what I just found, right? And so what he found was this, which he knew about, but he hadn't made the link, okay? Okay, more spinning plates, hang on. This is, it's translated in English, but this was came out in 1758. This is a memoir by the ex-governor of the Louisiana Territory, which of course the French still owned, right? Louisiana Purchase, they hadn't sold that, you know, it was still French. Where he talks about the Western, retitled for the English, right? The Virginia and Carolina, right? And so an account of settlements, inhabitants, soil, climate, and products. He's then describing the whole, you know, the geography, this whole territory that he administered for a decade or so. And in that description is not only this map, which I'll get to in a second, but he describes the journey of a Yazoo Indian. Okay, now, rabbit hole number 5,000 here. So the Yazoo are a group in northwestern Mississippi. It doesn't particularly matter, except for this story, that this Yazoo Indian named Moncasht Ape, I'll blow this up here in a second, that he, Lepage du Prats, the ex-governor writing the memoir, received word, I don't know, that this guy, this Indian guy, had traveled up the Missouri, crossed over the mountains to this westward flowing river. And he got that report. Okay, let me blow up the corner here. So this is why Ives is shaking. So he'd gone up the, right, up the Missouri River, right? And then here's route, I can't speak French, route de Moncasht Ape. He crossed over then to the headwaters of this westward flowing river. Cette belle rivière, this beautiful river is shown without a name on the map that was given by an Indian, Sauvage, to Monsieur de La Hontan. Now, La Hontan was an early French, right, and a number of maps, and that name should ring a bell from the Great Basin, La Hontan Basin, this sort of thing, right? And he had some maps. We could go into another rabbit hole here, but based here, the Grande Rivière, according to Mr. de La Hontan, right, this sort of marshy area that flowed over to the Mississippi and down, right? So you go up to the headwaters of this long river, cross over the mountains, and then just float on down. The Belle Rivière, the beautiful river, shown without a name. So what matters is that Duprat believed this, whether Moncasht Ape even actually existed, that's a whole story in itself, or not. Duprat believed it, and Rogers saw this map, and the argument being, I'm skipping over a few steps here, but the argument being then, he says, I know what an Indian name for the beautiful river is, Oregon. It's the Oregon River, right? Duprat says, it was the nation of the otters. There's no ethnographic record of a group called the otters. Doesn't matter. It's that there's a westward flowing river flowing off the map that the French knew about from Indian sources that Rogers saw on a map, we'll get to that here in a second, that led him to realize there's another beautiful river. Now, another step here. So he knew that the Algonquin word for the Ohio River was Oregon. Okay. And it may be that he just, because he was trying to get money, right, from the British, the crown, right, to support his expedition, right? So he kind of, it's good enough. It's an Indian name to kind of gussy up his project, right? And that could have been. Rogers was kind of a dodgy character and interesting in his own right, right? But it could have been, in fact, perhaps more likely, it could have been that it was his Algonquin colleagues, many of whom were literate, who said, hey, you know what? No, we call this the beautiful river. Now it's the Ohio, the Seneca name, right? But you know what? We know there's another, because they'd seen this map, which was in wide circulation. There's another beautiful river out in the west. That seems a little more plausible, to us. But again, there's no written record, there's no archive. Okay. Now, let's go back to dates. Okay. So back to some spinning plates here. Remember LaSalle, 1682, the map maker of which produced that map that had the Olygin on it, okay? 1760, the fall of Montreal, fall of, so they move in the interior Great Lakes, English take possession, and Rogers, after 1765, gets command of Fort Michilimackinac. Okay, that's at the very tip of southern Michigan, right on the straits there. Okay, that's going to turn out to be important here. That accomplished, the British bring in regular troops, because remember, Rogers is an irregular. He's just a hero, but he's not. So he's retired. He's out of the service, right? And so he's looking for work. And he asked to be superintendent of Southern Indians in the Carolinas. So he goes down to Jeffrey Amherst, the head of British forces, and is a good friend of his, right? So why don't you go down and talk to Arthur Dobbs, who's the British governor of North Carolina, which he does, and it turns out, which he does, so in the fall of 1761 or the spring of 1762, he meets Dobbs, everything changes, because Dobbs is the main proponent of finding the Northwest Passage. He's the one who, in fact, who funded an ill-fated expedition in the 1740s that discovered Hudson Bay. I can't remember that history exactly, right? And so he's hot on this. So here's Rogers, the lion, the hero of the French and Indian War. Oh my gosh, this is my guy. Dobbs is old by then. He dies in 1765. But he fires him up, we think, probably for reasons that we explore in the text, that he saw the, among other maps, he saw the La Page du Prat's map then. He may not have seen it until he got to London in 1765. He's already fired up, but maybe, okay. And so Rogers proposes a plan in 1762 for a march out west. So he's clearly got a plan that's Dobbs. He's channeling Dobbs. 1765, he's in London trying to, and of course Dobbs has probably gave him introduction to influential people. He's mixing in those crowds. Maybe that's when he saw the Duprat's map and other maps. Okay. The British are preoccupied with other things, and they're not too keen on throwing much money at this harebrained scheme, right? As important as finding a westward route. But they give him a little money. They say, okay, why don't you go run Fort Michilimackinac for a while? And he has a mortal enemy politically in, I'm forgetting the, anyway, it's a rival of Jeffrey Amherst, who does everything to undermine Rogers. But Rogers gets enough of a thing together that he gets his buddies from back in Connecticut and the New England, the wars, Jonathan Carver and James Toot, and says, hey, you guys go out and find this River of the West. And when you come back, I'll have the money, and we'll figure this out, right? Well, so Carver goes off and does his exploration, which is the basis of his book that gives him the credit, right? But the whole Oregon name is Rogers. It's all Rogers. Carver's completely derivative. So they get back, and Rogers is in chains. He's been arrested because they've trumped up charges. He was like swindling on the beaver trade. And anyway, he's hauled off in chains to New York or whatever, right? And anyway, Rogers is kind of out of the picture a little bit, okay? So Carver gets the credit, and that's where the story was left for so long that I started with, okay? So T.C. Eliot in the early 1920s then, sort of rehabilitates Rogers, and we find out the source of the story. Okay, so let's review now some of the spinning plates, right? Here's a key map, 1755, map of British and French Dominions in North America. 1758, we think this is the key map, because it describes perfectly the route. Let's go back. Forgive me for back and forth here, but that's the nature of this. The route Major Rogers proposes to take is from the Great Lakes towards the head of the Mississippi, remember, the head of the Mississippi, and from thence to the river called by the Indians Oregon, right? Now, there were three instances. Rogers never said what the word meant, and he never said where he got the word, okay? There are three times that he issued their printed, you know, written instructions. We detail all this in the article. And each time gets a little more refined, right? But it's clear that he's relying on the maps, including the one I just showed you. Because on that map, remember, sorry, spinning plates, let's go back here. Sorry. On that map, remember, it looks like you can just go up to the, remember, to the head of the Mississippi, go up the river, the Grand or the Dead River of Lahontan, known, and just a short hop over the mountains. Of course, no European had been across the Rockies by this point yet. Look, it's just not very far. And then float down, and there you're on the river that the Indians call Oregon, right, to get to the Pacific Ocean, somewhere out there, okay? Now, one interesting point is that this map, you know, clearly shows the French had an idea of the Rocky Mountains and Big Out, but barely had been out there. And so we could fast forward a couple of decades to Lewis and Clark, and remember their surprise that Sacagawea saved them from. They got to the mountains and thought, oh, just hop over the mountain range, right, and there's the rivers, we'll just float down, right? Remember, they get to the Bitterroots, it's like, right, we're in deep doo-doo, right? This is a Sacagawea saved their lives, right? Because it turns out it's not just a simple mountain range like they kind of thought. It was a giant, obviously the Rocky Mountains, okay? So that's another, again, evidence of the French origins of these maps. Okay, so let me make sure then I finish the story, and it looks like we're on time, okay? Yeah. Rogers' journals published in 1765, okay? His concise description, these are the two books that I waded through, and it turns out he identifies, I can't remember which one, he identifies Captain Jacob, a Mohegan, who's a specific guy, who's his right-hand man, right? So it's again, it's an inference, but we think Captain Jacob told him Waregon means beautiful river, means, right? It's we're down to the person, right? Carver's book. Okay, so, of course, Rogers' plan fails. Carver barely, he kind of wandered around. He got to what's now the Twin Cities, the Falls of St. Anthony. You know, he didn't get very far in winter, and then they're out of money and out of food to come back. There's no money. The whole thing falls apart, right? Carver finally goes off to England, publishes his book. He's the great hero. It goes through multiple editions. He's the guy, right? Rogers is has an alcohol problem already. He's in trouble legally. You know, he's an interesting character. He winds up, by the way, rabbit hole number 5002, he winds up being the guy who turned Nathan Hale in. I have but one life. I regret that I have one life to live, give for my country. That guy, right? He was sitting in a tavern on Long Island, right? And Hale comes in because he'd snuck across the Long Island Sound at night. Right? He comes in and tells it, blabs the story. You know, Rogers befriends him. Anyway, Rogers is a character. Okay. Anyway, he dies in poverty in London. The whole thing falls apart. In the meantime, 1792, we know Robert Gray discovers the mouth of the Columbia, names it after his ship. So, wait a minute, it's the Oregon River, it's the Columbia River. What's going on? Of course, Rogers didn't know the Columbia. He just knew that vaguely there was some big river or rivers out there. Okay, so we don't know if he was what he was thinking. And so the name Oregon, this is curious, almost fell into, just disappeared, until it was revived by William Cullen Bryant in a in this famous poem in 1817, Thanatopsis, I have a copy here, where he talks about, he liked the name Oregon, which he'd picked up from Carver, right? Where rolls the mighty Oregon, it was sonorous, right? And this sort of thing, right? And so it gets revived, okay, get the dates here now, 1817. Anglo, you know, white settlement, French settlements all already happening now out here in the, here where we are. And so Oregon comes then to name the territory, but not the river, because, well, because it's the Columbia River, right? So the name Oregon is the Oregon River is gone, okay? But it's the Oregon Territory, and then, of course, the trail to it. Now, let me make sure I've gone through everybody here. Yeah, okay. You can see why this was, it's so convoluted that, yes, okay. It's so convoluted that no wonder nobody figured this out. It took us 7 years to figure it out. Here's the Arrowsmith map of 1795. See, just after, so here's the River Oregon. He still names it the River Oregon, even though Gray is now championing Columbia, having crossed the bar. Fort Vancouver, right? This is, of course, the British settlement, because, of course, the British thought the eventual boundary between the expanding United States and the British dominions to the north was going to be the Columbia River. That's why Fort Vancouver's on the north side. Here's the Arrowsmith map of 1802, carried by Lewis and Clark, and you can see, of course, you know, it starts to peter out, right, and then it's a blank, right, and then there's a little bit out here. So they were trying to get out to the Columbia Territory or the Oregon District. Now we're away from Rogers and the main story, but just to wrap it up here, right? And so here's in the wake of the War of 1812, the British and the U.S. decide, hey, let's not go to war again. We'll just agree to disagree, and you know the history of this, right? We'll just agree to disagree, we're going to have joint occupation of Columbia Territory. Nobody's going to claim it. We'll just agree to disagree, okay? Well, in the meantime, of course, you know, U.S.ers, Americans are flooding in. The Oregon Trail really starts to, and so things are heating up, and finally, in the 1840s, James Polk champions the cause of claiming the entire Columbia Territory for the U.S., 5440 or fight, you remember that, which means clear up here, the extreme U.S. claim, because, of course, in the meantime, the Russians, right, the boundary was here. Okay, so Polk wisely, you know, he gets into office, but then, let's not go to war over this, right? This doesn't make any sense. Other things are going on. Things are heating up in Mexico. Okay, so they just agree on the boundary, which was going to be the boundary back in 1818 anyway, right? Anyway, cooler heads prevailed, right? And then they adjusted it here, there, of course. And so it becomes the Oregon Territory. Oh, the Wilkes map of 1841 showing the Columbia District just prior to what I just described. Sorry for the quality. But here's the Oregon Country in 1843. Okay. Oh, yeah, still prior to the settlement of 1848. But this is interesting because, of course, Oregon City was the end of the trail. And the boundary, the geographic, what do you call it, the geodesic, what do you call that, a boundary marker anyway, was right there. And so the four counties, this is wild, of the Oregon Territory, right, are the quadrants away from Oregon City, right? So everything to the northeast is Clackamas County out to the Rocky Mountains, right? Everything to the northwest is Tualatin County. Is that wild? Everything to the southwest is Yamhill County, which is a Kalapuyan word, and everything to the southeast is Shampooey County. And they had to have some administrative organization of this. And of course, things are happening quickly. The Oregon Trail then to Oregon City, to the Oregon Country, the Oregon Territory, right? And of course, here's a map of the Columbia Basin with the British, of course, thinking that the settlement's going to be north of the Columbia River. But in 1848, it becomes the line there that we know now, of course. And just the evolution of the territory, then 1848, the Oregon country, after the settlement with the British. 1853, Washington Territory is created, so the Oregon Territory is that. And then finally, 1859, of course, caught up in the politics of the Civil War and slave and free states, and we know all that, the state of Oregon comes to be what we know it now. Okay, well, let me stop there and entertain any questions or comments. Gosh, we finished with a little time for Q&A. I thought I might go long. So, any questions or comments that anybody might have? A million spinning plates, I have to apologize, but that's what it is, right?
So the original Mohegan word.
Mohegan. Right, but So the question was the original Mohegan word meant beautiful river.
Right, I'm questioning whether it means beautiful or navigable.
Or navigable, right. It's a general word, and I'd have to have Ives to really flesh that out. But it's a word that passed into jargon. It's the way that native speakers of Mohegan would speak to native speakers of English. In jargon. It's not actually directly the way they would say it in Mohegan. But it transferred over, and again, those details are in the article. But and I don't think I have a picture of it, but in the article, there's a headstone of a Mohegan chief, because the word passed into jargon and was circulating in Connecticut. In fact, there's a town just near Plainfield, eastern Connecticut, that's Waregan. This is the same name in the Mohegan country, right? Not far from the big casino, I think, out there. Royal Sun or something. Sun. In fact, I called up a pizza shop in Waregan and said, how do you say Waregan, just in case, to find out, you know? But there's a headstone in the burying ground of the Mohegans from 1780s or something. It says a chief, Uncas, I believe, for things noble, for things Waregan, he was the glory of Mohegan. Suggesting that they pronounced it Waregan, Ives is not so sure. So it's more, again, it gets into the linguistic details, but it's the pitch goes up, but not the stress. So it's Oregon, right, that English speakers heard. Of course, how Rogers pronounced it, we don't know. And that we get into the details of that. But in any case, the way we say it, Oregon or Oregon, come from Bryant. They don't come from some oral tradition going back to the Mohegans, if that makes sense, right? Yeah. So it's a jargon word is the idea.
Rather than a river that you would have to portage your canoe over.
Well, but I'm trying to say that the jargon word Waregan referred to, like I said with the burying, the epitaph, you know, good, bold, right? It came to mean had that broader meaning, not just a river. So in fact, the Algonquin word was Waregan Sibo. It's a bold, good river. In itself, it doesn't mean river. It means that's a bold, good, right? That's kind of the idea. Does that make sense? Yeah. Other questions or comments?
So on that last map, that was sort of a breakthrough map.
Yeah.
Together
yes.
River label?
Yes, Belle Riviere.
Do I take that was the Columbia?
No, the French didn't know.
Well, what river is that?
Who knows? But it's a great westward flowing river on the other side of the mountains that the locals called the beautiful river, but we don't know what their word for it is, right? Without a name, according to the map given by an Indian to Mr. De La Hontan. don't know what the name was, but it is an Indian name that means beautiful river, right?
Okay.
Duprat is reporting that. Rogers picks it up, right? And then he names the river the name that means the same thing, right? Beautiful river. Now, an interesting little footnote in the absence of any questions is we published in 2004, and that's just on the eve of when the State Quarter came out. And I thought, wouldn't this be great, right? Now that we know what it means. Well, we think we know what it means, right? To get the design into the State Quarter. Beautiful River, that's pretty cool. That's a good name, right? They were already too far down the road with the It's a Beautiful Coin, but anyway, that didn't happen. Now, let me maybe end on the note of plausibility. Because, of course, there's no smoking gun document, so the historians, in particular, turn their hair out, because there's no actual document that says, I, Robert Rogers, you know, bestowed this name. It's all, you're right, surmising from a wealth of complex, convoluted information, right, that this was what it means, and I think we're on extremely solid ground. But it's just degree of plausibility, plus Occam's razor, despite all the wealth of detail, that this is the simplest model that accounts for everything we know. It isn't just making up a name that sounds right, and, you know, because there are many names that, words that sound similar from one language to another. So it's a pretty cool story, if I might say, me aside, that it ties together the whole history of the country from New England and the fur trade and Lewis and Clark. And of course, Lewis and Clark never found the name. They knew they were going to the Oregon, because they had Carver, but they never found the name. They just sort of gave up. Oregon, I don't know, what is it, right? Which again points to, all these pieces add up to point to a New England origin. Right? We had hoped to have a Mohegan representative come out, because we were awarded the annual Joel Palmer Prize, which is a wonderful honor, who was the Indian superintendent in Dayton, lived in Dayton, the Palmer House. You may be now there, great restaurant. And so that was a wonderful award. And we were trying to engineer getting a Mohegan representative out, which would have been cool, but it didn't happen anymore. Right. Please, yeah, Jeff.
So what's the earliest reference to the Oregon Territory? Describe that you ran into while you were chasing this down.
Yeah, that's a good question. I can't say for sure, because it's all after Rogers, right?
But it
may not be till
before
Bryant. I think it's not till Bryant.
Lewis and Clark, it existed before Lewis and Clark.
Gosh, did Lewis and Clark talk about going to the Oregon country? They might have, yeah. And of course, Lewis and Clark, in a way, Rogers prefigures Lewis and Clark's expedition, right? But in fact, I did have a map that showed, forgive me, I'm sorry, back and forth, but it's all these spinning plates, right? Here, right? You could see, here's Rogers' idea. You go to the head of the Mississippi, right? Excuse me, head of the Mississippi, and then you cross over, and then somewhere over the mountains is this westward flowing river, roughly. But maybe, again, this is Indian geographic knowledge through the French, right? Maybe they were talking about the Fraser River. Nobody knows. It kind of doesn't matter, actually. Or maybe they were talking about the Columbia, but, right. And so Lewis and Clark followed, because they had Carver. You know, why didn't they just go this way, right? Well, they followed Carver, because he's got the map. This is the best geographic knowledge, right? Up the Missouri, and they're saying, gosh, cross over the river and find the westward flowing river. And then they ran into trouble, and then they finally found it. We know the story. Please.
Have you heard much about Alexander McKenzie and seen any maps of his travel?
Excellent question. I didn't pursue McKenzie. 1785? When did McKenzie,
somewhere around there, yeah.
Who's the first
Before
European?
Lewis and Clark, anyway.
Yeah. He's the first European to to cross the Rocky Mountains.
Right.
Mackenzie River, right, right. Of course, the U.S. And British competition over this territory is huge, right? And establishing the Fort Astor was crucial. Lewis and Clark, of course, crucial. It's only a few years later, right?
It wasn't the Hudson Bay?
Hudson Bay Company, yeah, yeah. And Fur Company. It's real interesting. Things start happening real quick. Of course, the Indians here get the brunt of all this. Diseases and right, we have a pretty good idea of that story. Right? So it's a little far away from here that the name emerges, and that's why it's such a mystery. People kept looking for a name from somebody who came here, right? I mean, that's the weird thing. It's a name that nobody ever thought of who lived here or got here, right? It's a name from a faraway place. Well, let's stop there. I think we're at the hour. And thank you for your attention. I appreciate it.